In lecture series on introduction to radar systems, now we are going to discuss microwave tubes, and in this particular topic we will discuss many oscillators like reflex klystron. Before going to the microwave tube, let us have a look the conventional tubes. This is called the diode, vacuum diode. It consists of cathode, which is there is some filamentary arrangement. This is heated cathode, this is the heater, so there is a filament associated with it, and anode is connected to the positive polarity of the power supply and cathode is connected to the negative polarity of the power supply. This thing is in vacuum at very low pressure. When the power is given, negative potential is given to the cathode, and the cathode is hot enough by this heater, then the electrons are released from this cathode and they are coming to the anode, because anode is in positive potential. So some current flows from anode to cathode direction. But if this potential is reversed, then the thing is just opposite and no current will flow, because anode will not be able to emit any electrons because it is not heat enough, hot enough. So current will stop. So this is the basic function of this vacuum diode. Now if we insert some wire mesh in between cathode and the anode plate, and that wire mesh is called the grid, then it becomes a triode valve. In this case, grid potential will control the flow of electrons from cathode to anode, because being a negative charge, electron will be repelled or attracted by this grid potential. So if the grid potential is negative, then some electrons will be repelled back, so the anode plate will receive less amount of electrons, so the current will fall. So in this way, grid actually controls the flow of electrons inside this vacuum tube. Rather, it controls the current between this cathode and anode plate. And this whole thing works up to a few megahertz only. It is better to use it in kilohertz order, but it can go up to megahertz with diminished amount of gain. To enhance the gain, we have to insert few number of leads or grids rather inside the space between cathode and anode. So now we have three wire mesh inside the space. This one is called the grid, conventional triode grid. Another is screen, another is the suppressor, and this device has got five leads, so it is called the pentode. So basic problem of this triode valve was the frequency, but pentode can operate with much higher amount of frequencies. So these are few conventional tubes that were used in previous days, but with time most of the tubes are replaced by solid state devices. But when we are considering the case of microwaves, we have got several problems associated with this type of tubes. So let us try to understand those problems. So limitations of conventional tubes. The first limitation is inter-electrode capacitance and lead inductance effect. Second one is transit time effect, and third one is gain bandwidth product limitation. So let us try to understand these problems or limitations one by one. First, we'll consider the inter-electrode capacitance and lead inductance effect. The inter-electrode capacitance and lead inductances are the order of 1 to 2 picofarad and 15 to 20 millihenry respectively. The shunt impedances due to inter-electrodes becomes very low, and series impedances due to lead inductance become very high at the microwave or higher frequency regions, which makes these tubes unstable. Refinements have been done in the design and fabrication of these tubes with the result that these tubes, like for example disc seal tube, are still used up to the lower end of the microwave spectrum, but those are not popular tubes. Consider the next limitation, transit time effect. In a conventional tube, electrons emitted by the cathode take a finite, which is non-zero, time in reaching the anode. This interval, called the transit time, depends on the cathode-anode spacing and the static voltage between the anode and the cathode. Now, transit time tau can be written as D by V, where D is the cathode and anode spacing, the distance between cathode and anode, and V is the velocity of electrons within that region. At higher frequencies, the polarity of the field would change, and even for more higher frequencies, it may change for several times within one transit time duration, and that would disturb the usual flow of electrons from cathode to anode. So this is what we call the transit time effect. Next one is the gain bandwidth product. For conventional tubes, the product of gain with bandwidth is constant. If high gain is required, then we have to sacrifice the bandwidth and vice versa. In microwave domain, high gain as well as high bandwidth is required. And that can be achieved in microwave tubes by the use of resonant cavities or slow wave structures. And apart from these three limitations, these are the basic limitations. Some other limitations are also there, like skin effect losses, dielectric losses, radiation losses are also present in the conventional tubes at higher frequencies. At lower frequencies, we don't consider those losses and those effects because these effects are extremely small to consider. But at higher frequencies, these effects predominate, and those tubes, conventional tubes, become unusable practically. Now look at the classifications of microwave tubes. Classification may be of different type. So first consider, based on whether the magnetic field is explicitly taking part in the interaction process between RF field and the electrons. So based on that criteria, we have two kind of tubes. One is the linear beam or O-type tubes, or the original type tubes. In this case, magnetic field is not present, or if present, it is used just to focus the electron beam. That means magnetic field is not taking part in interaction process, explicitly taking part in the interaction process. The example is multi-cavity klystron, which is an amplifier. Another type of such tube is based on magnetic field is explicitly taking part in the interaction process or not. So other type is the crossed field tube or M-type tube, magnetic type tube. Here, magnetic field applied in perpendicular to the electric field, that is why it is called the crossed field, that explicitly takes part in the process of interaction between RF field and the electrons. The example is crossed field amplifier. Now we have other kind of classifications, like based on whether resonant cavities are used or not. So based on that, we have resonant type tube. Here the resonant cavities are used. The example is magnetron. Another type is non-resonant, where resonant cavities are not used. The example is traveling wave tube or TWT. Just like conventional tube, they have different, completely different principle of operation. microwave tubes has got several distinct principle of operation which is completely different from that of the conventional tube. So let us try to understand the basic principle of operation of microwave tubes. Electrons emitted from filament are focused and accelerated by electric or magnetic field. Electron bunches are formed inside the tube. This is the new thing, because we have to form the electron bunches inside the tube. These electron bunches interact with the RF field present inside the tube in a suitable way. And during this interaction, electron bunches give up a portion of their energy and the RF field absorbs that energy. Thus, the strength of the RF field inside the tube is enhanced. So in this way, the amplification takes place. And this is the basic principle of operation for any sort of microwave tubes. And this is completely different from the conventional tube operation. Now, depending on the various structures, this bunch formation, this electron interaction, they are completely different. That means for each tube, we have different kind of electron formation, electron bunch formation, different kind of energy interaction. So that is why we have different type of tubes. So we are going to discuss few of them only. So first consider the reflex klystron tube. So consider the features. It's an O-type microwave oscillator tube. This is not amplifier, this is oscillator. Its power is low power output, 10 to 500 milliwatt output power at frequency range of 1 to 20 gigahertz. Efficiency is about 20 to 30%. Requires 3 DC inputs. One is for filament current, another is for anode or beam voltage, and another is for the nipplar voltage. Application of such reflex klystron, it can be used as a source of microwave in laboratory, as local oscillators in commercial or military or airborne Doppler radars, and pump oscillators in parametric amplifiers. This is one of example of reflex klystron tube. This type of tubes are used in microwave laboratories also. Now, reflex klystron consists of filament, cathode, focusing anode, reentrant type cavity and repeller. So this one is the filament. Filament is very close to the cathode so that it can heat up the cathode. Then we have some focusing anode. This is the focusing anode arrangement. Next we have reentrant type cavity. This is the reentrant type cavity. This reentrant type cavity consists of actual metallic enclosure along with some wire mesh. So this section is the wire mesh so that electron can pass through, and these are the metallic enclosures. They are connected. Actually, this is a cylindrical structure and we are observing its cross section. So at the center part we have wire mesh. It is just like a toroid shape. So at the center part we have the wire mesh, and at the rim part we have the metallic enclosure, and in the metallic enclosure we have some output port, because it doesn't require any input port because it is an oscillator. And there is another electrode called the repeller. So here we have the repeller. The function of the repeller is to repel the electron beam like this. So electrons will come or emitted from the cathode, they will pass through this wire mesh, they will try to reach to the repeller, and the repeller will repel back to the cavity again. And generally repeller is at negative potential and anode is at maintained at positive potential. Now let us consider the principle of operation. Electrons emitted by cathode are focused and accelerated by anode to form a stream of electrons. Now, while passing through cavity mesh, the electrons are velocity modulated by the RF field present inside the cavity. So some of the electrons are accelerated and some are decelerated. So try to consider the situation with the help of a figure. This is called the Applegate diagram. So let us consider three electrons, X, Y and Z. And three electrons are such that X has passed the cavity earlier, then Y electron, and finally Z electron. Corresponding field inside the, this is the situation of the field inside the cavity. Now from where the field is coming? Actually this field is started from the noise. Once you switch on the component, the current will change. There will be some fluctuation in the current and that will produce the enough noise, and the cavity will select a particular frequency, this frequency. So initially this amplitude will be very very low because it is coming from the noise. Afterwards this amplitude should be enhanced to produce steady source of energy. Now when X is passed through the cavity mesh, the RF field was at its higher potential part, positive potential part. So X is accelerated. This is how we have chosen these three electrons. Now when Y is passed through the mesh, the RF field was at its zero condition. So there will be no change in its velocity. But when Z electron was passed, this Z electron will face a negative polarity of the RF field. So actually it gets decelerated. Mind it, X was passed earlier, then Y, then Z. But after passing through the cavity mesh, the velocity of the electron X is enhanced. Velocity of Y electron was the same, and velocity of Z electron gets decelerated or gets reduced. So this is the condition. So X electron penetrates more in drift space, as you can see in this Applegate diagram. This is the repeller with negative potential. So electrons will try to go towards the repeller, but being a negative potential, repeller is kept at negative potential, electrons will be repelled back towards the wire mesh again, of the cavity again. But since X electron was accelerated, so it will penetrate more in the towards the repeller, and thus it takes more time to reach the cavity during its return path. Situation is just opposite for Z electrons. Thus, during return to the cavity, all these electrons X, Y and Z during its return journey towards the cavity, electrons will catch each other to form electron bunches. There is a chance. These electrons are called the favored electrons. So near the cavity, during its return journey, all these three electrons, and including all the electrons in between, actually it will start from this portion to that, all the electrons from that portion. So all the electrons between these two levels, these two points, will produce electron bunches near the cavity. If electron bunches return to the velocity, return to the cavity after an interval of integral multiple of 3 by 4 of the time period. That means if we start from this point as a reference, this is the reference electron. So if the electron bunch return at this point as shown in this figure, so here this time difference, time distance is 3 by 4 of the time period. as you can see, from this point to that point it is capital T. So from this point to that point it's 3 by 4 of capital T. So if the electron bunches return after 3 by 4 of the time period or integral multiple of 3 by 4 of the time period, then during its return journey the condition is such that again the RF field is at its positive polarity and electrons will experience a repulsive force from the RF field. So electron velocity would reduce, and that velocity reduction implies that electron bunch would lose its energy. And where the energy will go? The energy will go obviously to the RF field. So if the bunches are returned at the positive polarity side of the or positive polarity phase of the RF field, then the energy interaction takes place in a favorable fashion. That means the electron will lose energy and RF field will gain energy. And it happens if the return time is 3 by 4 of T or integral multiple of 3 by 4 of T. That means return time T0 equal to n plus 3 by 4 of T. In that case, the bunches will deliver their energy to the RF field present inside the cavity. Thus, the field inside the cavity enhances and can be taken out through output port. So this is the basic principle, but that is not all. What will happen to the other electrons? The electrons emitted within this region. What will happen? Now, for each value on n of n, we have one mode of oscillation, and these modes are expressed in terms of mode number n. That means if electron reaches, this is the closest time, shortest time. So electron have started its journey here and it is reaching to the just next or adjacent peak. So for that n equal to 0. But if it reaches to the next peak, so this one is one time period, that means it will be delayed by another time period T. That means the time delay will be starting from this point, this is 3 by 4 of T, then plus T. That means 1 plus 3 by 4 of T, like this one. The electron outside of bunching limit are not able to form the bunches and are called unfavored electrons. So electrons within these portions are actually will not follow this principle. They will not form the bunches and they will not come back in proper time also. So these electrons are called the unfavored electrons. Now, unfavored electrons extract the energy from the RF field. Instead of giving energy, they are actually extracting energy from the RF field in random fashion, giving rise to noise in output waveform. Now, the return time of electron bunch depends on the repeller voltage, which is kept at negative potential. Less the magnitude of repeller voltage, larger is the return time. That means here, this red color of figure, the repeller voltage is higher. For this color of figure, repeller voltage is lower. So less the magnitude of repeller voltage, larger is the return time, more is the mode number, and larger is the debunching of electrons. Now what is the meaning of debunching? See, all the electrons are negative charges, unit negative charges. So if you keep a number of electrons together for longer period of time, being same charge, they will try to repel each other. That means initially there will be a bunching, but then there will be a process called debunching. So they will try to get away from each other, and because of this debunching phenomena, the energy interaction becomes lower. So larger the mode number, less would be the output power. So if you consider the output power versus repeller voltage, as you can see, this is the direction of higher repeller voltage magnitude. Repeller voltage itself is negative. So for n equal to 2, the power would be higher. For n equal to 3, the power would be lower. For n equal to 4, power will be still lower, and so on. So more the mode number, lesser will be the output power because of this debunching phenomena. Also, for each mode, this is for n equal to 3, this is for n equal to 4, etc. For each mode, the frequency varies by small amount with repeller voltage in a regular fashion. This is called the electronic tuning. So we can, if we adjust the repeller voltage within this limit, we have some change in frequency like this. So this frequency is F0. So if we decrease the repeller voltage little bit, the magnitude of the repeller voltage, then frequency will increase, and otherwise the frequency will decrease by small amount, not much, maybe tens of megahertz change will be there. This is called the electronic tuning because we can change the frequency electronically. The other type of tuning is the mechanical tuning, where the size of the cavity is changed to change the frequency, and that change can occur in gigahertz order range even. So let us stop here, and we will see you in the next class.